SpaceX has reached a major milestone on its journey to Flight 10, marked by record-breaking achievements. But the company's efforts go beyond just preparing for its next launch. Starship has made significant progress in establishing its operations in Florida. Meanwhile, Japan's latest lunar lander has faced a setback during its landing attempt. Let's dive deeper in today's episode of NR Studio. The progress of Booster 16 has been the focus following the excitement surrounding Flight 9. Fans eagerly awaited a follow-up, something powerful enough to power Starbase once again, and the moment did not disappoint. Initial excitement was high when the first static firing attempt ran into some technical snags and was ultimately canceled. But as previously demonstrated, a second chance is always on the horizon, and SpaceX took full advantage of it. As the test approached, all standard procedures were diligently followed, including system venting, propellant loading, and engine cooling. The fuel configuration remained consistent with the previous test, with a full third methane tank and a full liquid oxygen tank. A key indicator that the test was imminent was when the water deluge system kicked in, filling the launch pad with about 350,000 gallons of water. This helped reduce thermal and acoustic stress during the ignition, protecting the launch pad infrastructure. Then came the moment everyone had been waiting for. All 33 Raptor engines on Booster 16 fired, producing an astonishing 7,000 tons of thrust. The static fire lasted about 9 seconds, consistent with previous tests. Unlike previous ignitions that varied thrust mid-test to gauge flexibility, this test appeared to focus solely on producing sustained output. It appears that SpaceX is now confident in the flexibility of the engines and is focusing more on testing durability and stability. No anomalies or issues were reported after the test, indicating a successful outcome. This milestone represents significant progress for SpaceX as it prepares for Starship Flight 10. Additionally, the event set a new record, with the B-16 static fire occurring just 9 days after Flight 9, surpassing the previous record set by B-13, which was tested 11 days after Flight 5. This rapid turnaround came as a surprise to many, including seasoned observers. After Flight 9, concerns were raised about the booster's quick disconnect system, and it was anticipated that a fix would take much longer. Instead, SpaceX deftly resolved the issue and resumed operations ahead of schedule, providing a valuable advantage for future launches. It remains to be seen whether B-16 will be used. Upcoming tests and future plans for the Starship program, SpaceX is poised to conduct additional tests, including firing one or two engines to simulate a potential dual-engine landing scenario. These tests could serve as a backup strategy in the event of an unexpected flight anomaly. However, if such tests are to be conducted, they must be conducted quickly. A scheduled ramp closure on June 7th from 5 a.m. to 9 a.m. suggests that Booster 16 will likely return to Mega Bay. Once there, Booster 16 will undergo post-test inspections and installation of critical systems, such as the hot staging ring and flight termination system. As Booster 16 transitions to the next phase, the focus will shift to Ship 36, which is expected to complete its engine installation soon and head to the Massey test site for static fire testing. Ship 36's testing is anticipated to be more rigorous, featuring multiple static burn attempts with varying amounts of fuel and thrust levels. This critical testing will prepare the craft for tasks such as reigniting its engines in space. After completing this test, Flight 36 will return to Mega Bay 2 for further inspection and final integration. During this phase, SpaceX will closely monitor the results, flag any anomalies, and implement any necessary adjustments or improvements, as every detail is critical to ensuring the success of the mission. So what do you think? Will Flight 10 launch this month? Feel free to share your predictions by answering yes or no in the comments below. And don't forget to like the video and subscribe to our channel to stay updated on every step of SpaceX's incredible journey. Looking ahead, if Flight 10 is successful, it will begin a new, stronger chapter for the Starship program. SpaceX has made significant preparations to meet these future demands. One of the most exciting developments is the advancement of Starship operations to Florida. The U.S. Department of the Air Force recently released a draft environmental impact statement that focuses on the reuse of Launch Complex 37 at Cape Canaveral Space Force Station for future Starship launches. The launch pad, which previously served the now-retired ULA Delta IV Heavy, has been inactive since 2023, but is now being considered as a dedicated platform for Starship. the transition could substantially expand SpaceX operational presence on the East Coast. A draft environmental impact statement details plans to convert LC-37 into a fully functional Starship launch site. The document is currently available for public review until July 28th. Notably, all environmental factors have been assessed as having no significant impacts, except for noise and vibration, which would be expected from a vehicle as powerful as Starship. The Environmental Impact Statement, EIS, shows promising prospects for approval of the Starship expansion plan. But the real excitement lies in the implications it will have for Starship's future. If approved, Launch Complex 37, LC-37, is expected to host up to 76 Starship launches annually. This includes 76 static test firings for Starship and another 76 for the Super Heavy booster, along with 152 landings, 76 for each stage. When combined with the approved annual missions from Launch Complex 39A, LC-39A, this results in a total of 110 Starship flights annually originating from Florida alone. Notably, LC-37 is set to be the more advanced launch facility of the two. According to a comparative analysis presented in the EIS, LC-37 uniquely meets all of the operational requirements for high-frequency Starship launches, while LC-39A is limited by its dual-purpose role supporting Falcon 9 missions, which impacts the availability and flexibility of its infrastructure. The EIS also outlines plans for new support infrastructure at LC-37, including a launch tower, fuel storage and delivery systems, landing zones, and other critical components. These developments reflect a long-term commitment to increasing Starship's role in Florida's launch ecosystem. Another key aspect highlighted in the report is Starship's advanced design, likely to be version 3. The upcoming Starship variant is projected to be 93 feet, 150 meters tall, with a 263-foot, 80-meter Super Heavy booster and a 230-foot, 70-meter upper stage. Fuel capacity is expected to be 100 metric tons for the Super Heavy and 2,650 metric tons for the Starship. Importantly, the Super Heavy booster will be equipped with 35 Raptor engines, while the Starship itself will have 9 engines, which will combine to produce 103 megatons, about 11,500 tons, of thrust from the booster, and about 28 megatons, about 3,100 tons, from the upper stage. These advances illustrate Starship evolution not only in launch frequency, but also in scale, performance, and capabilities. Increasing engine count and thrust are critical to heavy lift missions, lunar missions, and even Mars cargo deliveries. However, while the goal of surpassing 110 launches per year in Florida is an exciting prospect, it's important to recognize that achieving such a high launch frequency won't happen overnight. Even with a quick EIS approval, SpaceX will need time to finalize the design, secure contractors, and begin construction. In the meantime, Starship launches will continue to occur at LC-39A, where upgrades are underway, including an upgrade to the launch tower with a new orbital launch cradle. The ambition is bold, the groundwork is underway, and momentum is building for Starship's promising future in Florida. In a significant moment for space exploration, SpaceX is set to embark on a new chapter, inviting enthusiasts to observe closely. Meanwhile, Japan's latest lunar landing mission has hit a snag after months of preparation. On June 5th, Japan initiated its landing attempt with the Resilience Lander, a project by the private firm iSpace. The mission aimed for a soft landing in the Mare Crisium region, known as the Sea of Cold, on the near side of the moon's surface. The desired landing was scheduled for 3:17 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, 1917 GMT, which translated to 17 a.m. on June 6th in Japan Standard Time. Unfortunately, circumstances did not unfold as intended. The lander seemingly crashed upon impact, marking iSpace's second unsuccessful attempt at a soft lunar landing. Telemetry data was lost approximately 1 minute and 5 seconds prior to the expected touchdown. Early investigations suggest that an equipment failure, particularly with the laser rangefinder, may have thwarted the lander's ability to accurately determine its altitude during descent. This scenario closely mirrored iSpace's first lunar endeavor back in April 2023, which also ended in failure when the spacecraft went dark just before landing. During a post-landing press conference, iSpace's founder and CEO, Tishi Hakamada, expressed disappointment while maintaining transparency, stating, "We aimed for Mission 2 to be a success, but we regrettably could not achieve the landing. Following the apparent failure, iSpace took to social media platform X to inform that attempts to reestablish communication with the resilience lander were ongoing, with engineers at the Mission Control Center working tirelessly. A subsequent update provided further insights, revealing that the lander failed to decelerate adequately for the necessary speed during the lunar landing. Current assumptions indicate that the lander likely experienced a hard landing, which occurs when a spacecraft impacts the moon at a much higher velocity than intended, likely leading to its destruction or severe damage. Under these circumstances, it is improbable that the spacecraft could survive to fulfill its scientific objectives or deploy its secondary payload, which included the Tenacious rover, developed in collaboration with the European Space Agency. The final confirmation of the mission's outcome came in a somber announcement from iSpace, delivered at 8 a.m. JST on Friday, June 6th. Communication with the lunar lander was not anticipated to be reestablished, leading to the conclusion that achieving the Mission 2 Milestone 9, which confirmed the lunar landing, posed significant challenges. As a result, the decision was made to terminate Mission 2. Nonetheless, the mission serves as a sobering reminder of the complexities surrounding a lunar landing. Since 2023, multiple attempts by various countries and private entities have failed, highlighting the severe difficulties associated with operating in the unforgiving lunar environment. However, each obstacle encountered yielded valuable data and insights. While the iSpace mission failed to land successfully, it did increase the collective understanding needed for future efforts. Both the Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency and international collaborators, including NASA, will use these lessons to improve their methodologies and systems. As the global community prepares for the return of humans to the moon in the coming years, especially through initiatives such as NASA Artemis, ensuring the reliability and safety of lunar landers, both robotic and crewed, remains a primary goal. That's it for today's episode. See you in the next episode, and thank you all for your support.